Father, thank you for the Word of God and how you've preserved it for us to have. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's go over the quiz from last week. We'll start with question number one. Bill, you want to do that one, please?
In what century did Greek begin to be written in small letters? That was the 9th century.
In the 9th century, small letters, as opposed to the capital letters.
Yeah.
It was written in the small letters. Number two, please.
To what were the
Magi schools
converted? They were converted to minuscule script.
Okay. That's large letters. We don't hear the word majuscules very often, but we heard it this week. Number three, Bill.
How many cursive manuscripts have been discovered? 2,764.
That's right. Number four, please.
What does Kenyon consider to be a good text? He says that there is some kind of agreement with the Vatican.
Yeah, so if B&L, if it agrees with B&L, if it's a good text, or the Vatican, it's an Alexandrian text.
Okay, I didn't say
B&L. The B and A, it's the B and A, Alexandrian's A, I'm sorry. The B and the A, the Vatican is an Alexandrian, is what you said, which is the right answer. That's wrong. We don't want to, that's what he says is a good text.
Say it again.
You answer the question. Understand what you answered?
The wrong answer?
No, you said the right answer.
Oh.
You said the right answer. But Kenyon thinks it's not a good text, but he thinks it is.
Yeah.
If it agrees with the B or the A, the Vaticanus or the Alexandrian text, he thinks it's good. Number five, Bill.
To where did Origen move after departing Alexandria, Egypt, Caesarea?
Caesarea, that's correct. And number six?
According to Wilkinson, what text was the Bible of early Eastern Christianity? Textus Receptus.
That's right, the Textus Receptus. Number seven. Go ahead.
I just thought it was so interesting how that was sort of hidden away in its own little area of the world.
Yes, it was interesting.
It's just waiting there to be discovered. Go ahead.
Number seven, Bill.
Name two early churches that preserved the precious manuscripts of God's words. Pella in Palestine and the Syrian church in Antioch.
Okay. Number eight.
According to Eusebius, what was the claim of those who were corrupting the scriptures? They said they were corrupting the script here instead of... I can't remember.
Well, so the people, the claim was... They said that the corruptors said they were correcting the scripture.
Well, that's correcting, is that word?
No, not, but they were corrupting the scripture. Bill.
That has been a sin among mankind, among most, if not not almost all of mankind, ever since the very beginning, because they came out of Satan's mouth originally.
Mm-hmm.
They felt that they were correcting the manuscripts because they thought they had better words. Or words that they thought better expressed what they wanted.
Yes.
And the whole thing is, if God breathed the original words in Hebrew and Greek, how can anybody improve on what God has to say? He created everything that exists.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
It's not possible for any human to create to better that.
It's not. That's right. Can't be it. Can't.
No, it's impossible.
Mm-hmm. 9, please.
Name the four chief heretics who lived after the death of the Apostle John. I found five.
Okay, name five then.
But I don't know if it's right.
Name all five or name
Martian
four?
Martian and the Gnostics. Yeah. See, that's the one I don't know if that's right. Justin Martyr, Clement of Alexandria, Origen, and Tatius.
Yeah.
I can't
She's right, though, because...
What was the last word?
Because... Before the four listed names, I think it's a paragraph or two paragraphs earlier, Marcion was talked about. And he was one of the originals that really corrupted the text of Scripture. So she's right in naming him as a fifth name.
Number 10, I guess it is.
It's your turn, Bill.
Okay, who continued to wear the robes of a pagan philosopher, Justin Martyr?
That's right. And
he was quite a treasure in his own eyes.
Yes. He was, wasn't he?
Just like Satan.
Number 11, please.
Who embraced Gnosticism after the death of Justin Martyr? Tatian or Tatian?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Number 12.
What did Clement of Alexandria incorporate into his teachings? Mixed pagan philosophy with corrupted scripture.
That's what he did. 13.
Who was Clement of Alexandria's most famous student? Tatian. Is that right?
Origen. Origen. Number 14.
Who had a substantial influence upon Jerome? Origen again.
Okay.
Who said the scriptures are of little use to those who understand them as they are written? Origen.
Okay.
That's an interesting point. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Because for a long, long time, the Catholic priests didn't allow scripture reading in English. Everything had to be in Latin, mm-hmm. and if you didn't understand Latin, you were left out in the cold.
That's right.
So they weren't really concerned whether people understood or not. They just wanted obedience.
Yep, that's all they wanted.
Okay, number 16. Mm-hmm. What happened on October 28th, 312? Constantine defeated Maxentius.
Okay, that's right. 17.
What was the effect of the Edict of Milan? Legalized Christianity.
Oh, I said when it's C, I spelled it wrong. I'm sorry, I spelled Edict wrong.
Edict of Milan.
Edict of Milan. Okay.
Did I do it wrong now?
No, I spelled Edict wrong.
Yeah, but did that have anything to do with the answer?
No.
Okay.
You ready for 18 Ann, or not?
No.
Fill in the right thing.
Why were the Waldenses objects of hatred and persecution? Because the Roman Church accepted a Bible that was corrupted by Origen, and they were seeking to control people through that.
Mm-hmm.
They were using their Bible as a means of controlling people.
And the right thing?
I thought it was because the Waldensians had a different Bible.
That's what he said.
Oh, okay. What Bible was used in the Greek Empire? The Textus Receptus.
Okay. And number 22.
How have some of the so-called church fathers harmed the authority of Scripture? No real respect for God's words. They thought they could choose words of their own, assuming that those words were better, and assuming that mm-hmm. their impressions were clearer mm-hmm. and better understood.
That's right.
Everything was assumed on their parts.
Both the assumptions, yeah.
That's yeah. Right.
Mm-hmm. Number 20, Mom.
Oh. I thought we had that one.
Well, you get the answer, too.
How some of the so-called church fathers harm the authority of scriptures. No respect for God's word.
You didn't have any respect for God's word?
That was the answer. I thought he gave it. Okay. I forgot to fill that in, so.
Okay, well, yeah, that's fine. I mean, number 20. How have some of the so-called church fathers harmed the authority of Scripture?
By corrupting it. By having Gnosticism. Bringing Gnosticism. Gnostic thinking.
Okay. That's right.
I lost it.
So, we've got a new section today about the Latin versions, and the survey of the early versions. Now, go.
What happened to Jacob?
Jacob and Mrs. Grummer aren't able to come today.
Oh, okay.
They have a conflict in their schedule.
Okay.
We'll
forgive them this time, but they must not miss any more classes.
Okay. We'll let them know. So, the early versions. Now, when we think of the Word of God, the precious Word of God being preserved for us, and at the very time of the New Testament, near the inception of the New Testament, shortly after it was canonized, and even times when we have it being preserved at that point of time. And we noticed in this section how sometimes the Eastern and the Western so-called church, in a generic sense, were separated from each other for millennia, for 1,000 years. And so
we have 1,000 years.
Yes, in certain parts of the world, you know, there was a disconnect for 1,000 years from the West and the East in certain regions of the world.
Yeah, I read that, but how did that happen?
They just weren't in communication. They lost communication with one another, and there could have been something related to either governmental agencies, rules, and so forth.
Or telephone lines were down.
Telephone lines were down, you know, that type of thing. But we'll get to that in a little bit.
Okay.
About that. But we have the conflict we see. We notice on page 134, here again the promise of Christ to preserve his word and the malicious intent of Satan to corrupt the same word came into titanic conflict. So this conflict of that Satan wants to come in and he wants to try and do what he can to change and to corrupt and to alter God's words. And we see here again, as far as he mentions about the Greek speaking world was used by God to help in keeping the Greek pure. God guided the movement of the church away from readings that which were false and misleading toward those which were true and trustworthy. So the true and trustworthy is what we have to accept. We must accept the true and the trustworthy accounts and readings of the Scripture, of the Word of God. And here again, on this page, next page, on page 135, he stresses the point as far as what does inspiration have to deal with. It deals with the Hebrew and the Greek. Inspiration does not deal with foreign languages. It deals with the Hebrew and the Greek only. And then when that Hebrew and Greek was given in the original, inspiration is a process. It is not a product. It's a process. Holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. It's a process. Now, as far as translations are concerned, if you didn't know Greek, you don't know Hebrew, you have to have a translation. Latin was a very popular language during first, second century up until, I forget when the Latin went out of existence, when it became dead. But Latin, we have here, we're reminded that the text Receptus, it's represented in the Latin, clearly represented in Latin. Not much study, he says, has been done as far as about certain things. And the studies that have been done about it pertain to the people that do these studies take a naturalistic approach to their study. They take a naturalistic position about this. And that's the wrong position to have. Hello. Nice to see you. Now, Tertullian, mentioned on page 135, he's the one that coined the word Trinity. Tertullian speaks of a complete Latin Bible. He was from Carthage. He speaks of a complete Latin Bible that was circulating there in northern Africa. Now, and this dates back to the second century, to 190 AD. So he says there's the Latin Bible, and he references the Latin Bible that's in existence. And this Latin Bible was translated from the proper Hebrew, Greek text, an Aramaic text. And so it existed in Tertullian's time. Now, Kenyon wants to say that you can't trust some of these church fathers and what they say. He wants to, he'll accept Origen, probably, which is bad. He'll say he'll accept Marcion, probably, which is bad. He'll accept Tatian, who is bad. But Tertullian? No, we got to watch out for Tertullian. You can't really trust him. He's not reliable. He's not trustworthy, according to Kenyon. But the point is, I think it's trustworthy when he references the fact that there is a Latin Bible. There's a Latin Bible that exists, that's in existence, a complete Latin Bible, in 190 or so. And then we have, it's called Scribner, and as far as Scribner is saying, this Latin Bible was there for the African Christians. African Christians that are in North Africa was there by 157. Italic is what it was called. The language was written in Italic. And when we think about that, that's very close. That's 57 years, 67 years after the close of the entire canon, after the Apostle John finished the book of Revelation. And so we have here, and then the ISBE references, ISBE's International Standard Encyclopedia, ISBE has a reference to this fact that the text, the Latin was translated right there in Antioch and was brought to North Africa. So it was right there where the original was. Now, strange as it may seem, the people that take the other position, for some reason they don't like texts that come from Antioch. But it's very, very reasonable to think that if indeed we have the testimony of Tertullian, that we have Scribner's observation. Tertullian puts it at 190. Scribner moves it down to 157. And ISBE is moving even closer, probably, to the time of the first generation copies of the Greek New Testament, or the Greek, over the direction of the time of when the last apostle was living, back 90 to 100 AD. Christian people came in Antioch, and the people in Antioch translated into the Latin to be taken and carried to North Africa, the Carthage, that's where Tertullian was from. I mean, we have all these countries that run across the northern coast of Africa, but it was the received text type. It was based upon the received text. Now, again, this is Kenyon speaking. I'm page 135. Kenyon, we have to take what he says very cautiously and weigh what he says because he's not trustworthy. At least in this area, he's not trustworthy, is what he's saying. This fact throws a great deal of light on Kenyon's statement. Many of the manuscripts of the Old Latin, certainly represent a different type of text from which we have found domiciled in Egypt, of which the foremost represent the Aleph and B. And so Kenyon is saying, well, wait a second here, this Latin text, it's different than the text that's in Egypt. It's different than it's as good. It's different than Aleph. It's different than B. It's different than A. It doesn't match up. Kenyon's acknowledging the fact there is a difference. Now, and arguably, one could say that this Latin text is older based on Tertullian's testimony, based on Scribner's observation, based on Scribner's testimony, Scribner's observation, I guess, and based on ISBE's observations and research, that it is clearly older than Aleph, then B, then A, then W. You keep on listing all your manuscripts. It's a very, very, very old source manuscript. And yet Kenyon is saying they're different. So Kenyon is almost saying, oh, it can't be a true text because it's different than the text of being Aleph. It doesn't agree. Well, because it came from Antioch. and the Antioch text was a pure text, Bein Aleph are impure texts. And Tertullian, it's often his quotes from the Old Latin. And here Burcanian says, oh, you can't trust him. Tertullian's not reliable in quoting from the Latin, but he is. He is reliable. And we know that Tertullian, we see here somebody that we know, affirming the fact that Tertullian quoted from 1 John chapter 5, verse 7.
Someone we know?
Yes, who would that be?
Dr. D.A. Wade.
That's right, page 136. Now, as we see, Kenyon does not want to admit the fact that the received text is represented in the Old Latin, but it is. And see, he wants to have the Alexandrian support for the Old Latin, but it's not there. He cannot give the Alexandrian support for the Old Latin, because the Old Latin came from the true text receptus, the true text. And, you know, if indeed it's true, it is originated, actually translated there in Antioch, where they had maybe a first-generation copy, you know, of it's only 157 years. We have documents today that are over 200 years in the museums of the country, Smithsonian museums. Granted, the paper is different. The paper we have today is perhaps maybe a little better than the paper they had yesterday. The ink is maybe a little better. But nonetheless, it's probably first generation, maybe a second generation copy of those original Greek words. And so it was there. But Kenyon doesn't want to admit it. He wants to back away, walk away from the whole thing, the fact that the Latin, Old Latin, is a clearer representation of what's in the received text versus what we find in B and Aleph and A. Wilkinson says on page 136, much, but by no means all of the Old Latin evidence is favorable to the received text. Not much it is. And so we know that the one text has been tampered with. The other text has not been tampered with. The text receptus has been pure. There's no confusion with the text receptus. But with the other one, there are level elements of confusion. Now, another interesting thing as far as the absence, the Old Latin is absent of something. It's absent of the Apocrypha. It does not have the Apocrypha in it.
Where does that say that?
Well, now see, the on page 136, the copies of the Waldensians had no Apocrypha in it. Now, the Apocrypha was added, but the addition that the Waldensians had, it did not have it. On page 136, you see that?
Yeah, I see it.
Now, we'll see shortly that even after Jerome's Vulgate, the Waldensians continued to use the Old Latin. And Vulgate, all Vulgate means is common or current. Common or current, and we see here a list that Kenyon makes up of some extant manuscripts that are listed in different fragments on pages 137. On page 137, he lists these Old Latin manuscripts and these different fragments of manuscripts that are listed there on page 137. And we see here, we know the Albigensians. I said think it's the Waldensians, but the Albigensians, they even once Jerome's Bible, his Latin Bible, was finished, his Latin version was finished, the Albanetians continued using the Old Latin. And so we see here an observation that he makes as far as how the gospel witness arrived in these different, in England and France and Italy and a few other countries. It didn't necessarily come directly from the Roman, the pagan institution of Rome. It came from Asia Minor. It came from where the gospel originated from. It came from there across the Mediterranean Sea. He says, you know, the Mediterranean Sea is like a trunk of a tree, branches that run out and run through parts, the roots of the tree being Judea or Asia Minor. And so...
Can you show us up there?
Yeah, this is you know, Asia Minor up here.
Yeah.
Up here, and then it comes over to the middle, and we can't even see these other countries over here. You know, Britain's over here.
Okay.
I mean, it's here. I mean, not that's Europe.
I understand where Britain is.
Okay.
So,
here's the Mediterranean Sea.
Oh, okay.
This is the Mediterranean Sea.
Okay.
The Great Sea and the Mediterranean Sea are the same thing. Sometimes Scripture refers to what we know as the Mediterranean Sea as the Great Sea.
Okay.
So this body of water, so you have Paul, when Paul makes his missionary journeys, he makes them, when he goes in a boat, he's in the Mediterranean Sea, usually.
Okay.
On all his missionary journeys, he was in the Mediterranean to go to these different places when he was in the water.
Okay.
And so what he's trying to say is the Mediterranean is like this, the trunk of a tree. It's like the trunk of a tree, and you have branches, you have different boughs that go out, and branches that go out from the main trunk. And so he's saying this was how the source, the gospel, the true word of God was able to come across and find its way into France, into Britain.
That's all
right. You know, it didn't originate from the pagan institution of Rome, but it originated from where they were first called Christians. In over there in Asia Minor and in Antioch and Jerusalem area, where the church began. That's where it came from. And so even in the case of the African, the Latin that Tertullian was talking about, that the Isbys referring to in their reference, that Scripture talks about, they came in Jerusalem and they came down, translated in Jerusalem, and they brought it to Carthage, North Africa over here. So when we think of how Rome, the pagan institution of Rome, wants to take credit for some of these things, they're not due the credit. What they get credit for, corrupting and perverting the text of Scripture. They don't get credit for anything else but that. On page 137, he says, the early Latin translations were very dear to the hearts of those primitive churches. God in his wisdom invested this Bible with a charm that overweighted the learned artificially of Jerome's Vulgate, the Bible adapted by the papacy. So we have one, that's the Bible of the papacy, Jerome's Bible. For 900 years, the old Latin held its own and was only replaced when Latin ceased to be a living language. So it was able to hold its own. It was not... Jerome's Vulgate did not supersede it in the areas where it was used. It held on until Latin went out of use, until the language itself became obsolete. It was used.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
Why does a language become obsolete?
A language has become obsolete and they become... transformed, or I forget where they become updated, because of cultural influence, I would think. Okay. Cultural influence. When the Roman Empire fell, Rome fell in 6. what year was it that Rome fell? Well, nonetheless, I'm sorry, I don't have that exact number. But when Rome, the Roman Empire collapsed, then the satellite countries in which it was at one point in which it was over, began adapting and bringing back old dialects and having combinations of Latin and their old dialects. And so basically, the Latin language was not known as Latin anymore because people started speaking other dialects that may have adopted a lot of Latin. I mean, English has some Latin in it. I mean, there's Latin there's evidence of Latin in many languages. Many of the Romance languages and other languages. We have excerpts of parts of Latin being present.
Migration, too.
People migrate. Yeah, that's
from
right.
Germany and France, they migrated to England.
Mm-hmm.
And they pretty much overtook the English countryside and replaced many of the original English there.
Right. Mm-hmm. We see the same thing with, like we mentioned, English. I mean, we have the Old English, the Middle English, and the Modern English. It goes through a transformation, the language does. And so Latin was completely left off on the sidelines. It was not used anymore. But yet, these Christians who knew Latin, they held on to the Latin, the old Latin, for until the language went extinct. The language was no longer spoken anymore. And it was replaced by a different language in that area of the world. They hung on to that. And he wants to he wants to stress the point that on page 139, Rome did not send any missionaries toward the west before 250 AD. The early Latin Bibles were well established before the churches came into conflict with Rome. So Rome sends their missionaries to the west, and what do they find? They find a true church already established. They find them having a true Latin translation of the scripture that's far superior to the one that they have. So in 250, that's the earliest date they would have sent any missionaries westward. But yet, the point being is the Latin Bible was there, not the one of Jerome, but the pure Latin Bible. The old Latin versions were used longest by the Western Church, who would not bow to the authority of Rome. That's on page 139. Look later on page 1. You got a question, Tim?
Well, I don't understand that quote. Because Rome did not send any missionaries to the West before 250 AD. Constantine didn't take over and
begin. You're right.
Mm-hmm. Until 325, was it?
You think of Milan, that's right. Maybe we got the date wrong.
No, maybe that's what it says
here. I know it says 250, but maybe the date should be 350.
So I'm just trying to figure out if they were sending, if Rome was sending missionaries, they would have been Christians. They wouldn't have been.
Yes, they would have been.
Pagan institutionalized Christianity. It would have actually been Christians. But Rome, I mean, it wasn't Rome as Rome. I mean, it was probably.
Yeah, the true Roman Church, the one that were the recipients of the letters that the letter of Paul wrote, the book of Romans, we know it's the book of Romans, that's one aspect. But I think
they would have been using the right Bible.
They would have been. But see, the reason why it's the pagan institution of Rome is it talks about conflict.
I know.
No, it's talking about conflict. But so I think the 250 date must be 350. It's got to be after 325, after the Edict of Milan, I would think.
Okay.
So we have to follow that up somehow. But that's a good observation, as far as that it doesn't line up with the date. And so, in later on, page 139, he says, when Rome awoke to the necessity of sending our missionaries to extend her power, She found Great Britain and Northern Europe already professing a Christianity whose origin could be traced back through Iona to Asia Minor. About 600 AD, Rome sent missionaries to England and Germany to bring these simple Bible Christians under her dominion, but as to subdue the pagans. So they were trying to win them back. But this date is 600. So, you know, maybe this date's supposed to be 650 back earlier. I don't know, because we have a 250 date, which is too early, I'm sure. And we have a 600 date, which is probably more accurate as far as when they were trying to do this. But they went, and when they went, they found that the people had the true gospel, and the people of Rome, of the pagan institution of Rome, were bringing a false gospel to them. And so it was the British missionaries who came, Bible-believing British missionaries, who brought the gospel of France, who brought the gospel of the Netherlands, who brought the gospel of Switzerland and Germany, and even back to...
From
England, Great Britain, England. And even into Northern Italy, the gospel was brought. And so there was this constant conflict. There's always a conflict with Rome, because Rome wants to do things the wrong way. They want to do things according to their tradition. They want to do things according to the false gospel. If anything, they're covenantal. They believe in replacement theology. They believe that they are the church. They are the new Israel. And so they are trying to bring a corrupt and perverted God. And furthermore, they have a gospel of works. And they wanted to bring this all back. They were trying to convert the British to their way of thinking. But when they got there, they found out the British were already, many of them had already accepted the gospel, the true gospel. You know, by faith alone, by Christ alone. The death, the burial, and resurrection. Scripture alone. No salvation by works. They got there. And then we have these because the gospel, the word of God came across the Mediterranean, all the way to Britain. And then the British were able to take it to France and parts of Northern Italy, Switzerland, to the Netherlands. And they were able to have a tremendous influence upon them. And so, consequently, you know, that later on, this is 1,000 years later, or whatever, 1607, 1623, I guess it is, when we have the pilgrims who are not necessarily from, but they come either further to the West with the Bible. Now, it's not a Latin Bible, it's an English Bible. It's the English Bible that comes across, not the Mediterranean, but across the Atlantic.
What's that translation called?
The Geneva Bible.
That's interesting.
If we're looking at page 140, we see here, the messengers of God who carry manuscripts from the churches of Judea to the churches of Northern Italy and brought the forerunners of the Waldensians Bible different from the Bible of Roman Catholicism. And so it was different. It was different. It was a pure text. Over page 140, there are clear proofs that doctrines, now listen closely, the doctrines unlike those which the Roman Church holds and conformable to the belief of the Waldensians and Reformed churches were maintained by theologians of the north of Italy down to the period when the Waldensians first came into notice. So there was the conflict of doctrine, very, very severe conflict of doctrine in a positive sense, because the doctrine of Rome, the doctrine of the pagan institution of Rome is wrong doctrine. And notice this observation near the bottom of on page 140, still continuing on, near the bottom of this paragraph. It held that the pre-Waldensian Christians of Northern Italy could not have held a doctrine purer than Rome unless their Bible was purer than Rome's. That is, their Bible was not on Rome's falsehood manuscript. It wasn't based on that falsehood manuscript. It was based on a good manuscript, a good manuscript, the text Receptus. And so we see a claim, a false claim, as far as the origination of the Waldensians. It's false claim that they were founded by the Waldo in 1175. But as the book says, if you see here page 141, Mormon says, this is a mistake. The historic name of this people is probably derived from the valley where they lived, Valdos. Their enemies, however, ever sought to date their origin from Waldo, because they don't like the fact of the Waldensian Bible. If they want to move it, they want to move it later rather than having it earlier. But the fact that we put it earlier, it demonstrates the fact that it came from the source text of the text Receptus. And so we see on page 141, still there remains to us in the ancient Waldensian language the noble lesson written about the year 1100, which assigns the first opposition of the Waldensians to the Church of Rome to the days of Constantine the Great, when Sylvester was Pope. So, the conflicts. The Waldensians. And they used this Bible that was based on the text Receptus. And so, and the persecution, of course, we have the Edict of Milan, we have the Constantine making it a state religion, so-called the Christianity. It wasn't genuine Christianity, it was the false Christianity of the pagan institution of Rome. That's what it was. It was a false Christianity that was forced upon the people. But nonetheless, we have a great persecution coming against those people who do not want to go along with what Constantine wants to do. Anyone that went to put that goes against the pagan institution of Rome was persecuted, and sometimes they are still persecuted today. People that are going against the pagan institution of Rome. We see on page 141 still, it was the translation to Latin which represents the received text. Its very name, Italia, is derived from the Italic district, the regions of the Valdos. And Valdos is where the Waldensians lived. The V, you know, is pronounced as W in this particular instance. And of the purity and reliability of this version, Augustine speaks of a different Latin Bible. Yes.
Is this Latin Bible the Textus Receptus?
Well, the Latin is a translation of the Text Receptus. When we're talking about the Old Latin, we're talking about a translation. Latin is Latin, it's a translation of the Greek. Greek is Greek. So we have the Greek, you know what Greek looks like. You've seen Greek, right?
Yeah.
Before. But the Latin has letters you're familiar with. It has an alphabet that you're familiar with, for the most part. There may be one or two letters that aren't in use anymore, but nonetheless, it looks like your alphabet. The alphabet you learned in first grade. Or whatever grade you learned it in.
Yeah, I think you learned it in first grade.
Okay. That's the alphabet you're familiar with. It's a Latin. What's a famous phrase in Latin? I came, I saw, I conquered.
E pluribus unum.
E pluribus unum. All these are Latin phrases. E pluribus unum. You understand, Latin is a language.
Yes.
Greek is a language, too. God gave us the scripture in Hebrew, Aramaic, and Greek.
Right.
And so, from that Hebrew, Aramaic, and Greek, we have a Latin translation.
Right.
Rabbi taught the studios.
Yes. Mater?
Mater. Something
like that. Studiorum mater. No, that's
not right. There's
a hand.
Okay, your hand.
When I was younger, I was told that Latin was a silent language and you don't speak it. Well, I took Spanish, but I never understood that because now we Bibles written in Latin where they read the Latin and everything, and then it went out of style.
To this present day, Latin is a dead language.
But
people do not speak it regularly today.
Right.
Although some people do speak it. But it was spoken in the ancient times.
Before Roman Catholicism, we had the Roman Empire, and the Roman Empire spread throughout a lot of Europe, and the language of that empire was Latin.
Yes.
And so that's why the language is known in written form, and it is an influence. The languages of those countries, their Romance languages. But it's not spoken any longer because the Roman Empire is long gone.
So, there's, you said unspoken versus dead. You see the difference? Is there a difference between your mind between unspoken and dead?
Yes.
What's the difference between your mind?
Well, if something's dead, it has no life. But you could just bring a Latin book and start reading it.
But practically speaking, it's...
But it's not
where is Latin spoken of? What country is Latin spoken?
The priest used to speak it.
Okay, all right. That's okay. We'll come back to that in a minute. then we'll come back to another thought, and then we'll go. Before you do that, we'll get Dana's thought.
Do you remember all these thoughts?
If something is a dead language, then that means that nobody has it as their first language.
That's what that means.
Well.
Nobody's language. It's just a language in a book.
Okay.
No, it's nobody's first language. In other words, my first language is English.
Right.
Some people's first language is Spanish. Other people's first language is Mandarin. Some people learn more than one language, but then that's their secondary language. When your first language is the language you speak, when you first begin talking, or you could be bilingual, grow up in a bilingual home. That, in other words, no one starts out speaking Latin anymore.
Correct.
When I went to school, my mother took some Latin in school.
Mm-hmm.
People used to always take Latin. That's before me, before my generation.
They taught Latin. There was an option to take Latin, at least in the school in this city.
Right.
That was in this borough. They had the option of taking Latin. I know
people took Latin.
People have been in that. But you take Latin so you can understand your language. You take Latin, you study Latin so you can understand other languages. And how we have words in our language today that come from the Latin.
Mm-hmm.
There's words in other Romance languages that come from the Latin. So you look at a modern day word. You say, "Oh, that comes from the Latin." You look in your dictionary, derives from the Latin word. Bill.
Yeah, a lot of Latin today is simply reserved for scientific terminology.
Okay. And see, you reserve it for scientific terminology because it's no matter if you speak what language, no matter what language you speak, if you have one Latin word that's scientific terminology, then no matter if you speak French, German, Italian, English. Spanish, name your language, Russian,
every
Chinese.
Every kind of animal in existence has a scientific term. In other words, I don't remember what the terms are for a lion or a tiger or something like that, but they do have a Latin designation.
Yes.
And it's that way with all animals, even fossils of extinct animals. They have scientific terminology to
right.
them, which is from Latin.
And see, that's why the pagan institution, the purr, for their unholy sacrifice, when they speak, at least before 1967, before Vatican II, it would all be in this Latin, this dead language, so that it would be the same no matter who you were. If you had some understanding of language, I'm not sure how many people did, but it would be always the same. Of course, they wanted to keep people in the dark.
Yep.
You speak a different language, you're going to miss most of it. I mean, I turned the radio on, I don't know, some time ago, and I heard some Spanish guys talking. Okay, I pick up one or two words. because my Spanish isn't the best. You know, some of that is better in Spanish. Like for it's you would pick up more than you pick up a lot of words. I'm sure you would miss one or two words. I just picked up one or two words, in Spanish, and so I don't get hung up as far as the Latin. When at this time they had this Latin Bible, the Latin language was not dead. The Latin language wasn't silent at that time. The Latin language was alive. The Latin language was heard at the time of these body
English
these today. Bibles. It was as common as English, like Tammy said today.
Well, then with this, the way I understood, they were like, where Rome was and all that, they had the Bible in Latin and everything. And like up there, for France and Spain and all them, they were kept in the dark. They were up there, and they didn't know it. The Bible was being changed, and they had the Textus Receptus up there. Is that right?
Yeah, that's correct. Yes.
So how did they decide?
Correct.
How did people decide when they discovered the Textus Receptus was hiding up there in its purity that was
the
right Bible?
The translation of the Textus Receptus was up there.
Oh, okay.
Latin is a translation. Latin is a language.
Well, what was it up there? It wasn't in the original language.
Roman Catholic Church controlled France.
The Latin based on the Textus Receptus. It was based on the Textus Receptus.
It wasn't the text. Okay.
But it was very early.
It was in Latin. It wasn't in Greek and Hebrew.
But it was based. The point being is, if you see a translation. If someone claims the Textus Receptus is whatever the claim is, but yet if you have you can produce a translation that's based on the Textus Receptus,
it's going to look different.
No, that means the Textus Receptus was in existence.
Yes.
It was in existence. If you have a TR reading in the old Latin, then they can't say West Comwork can't come along and say B Aleph and A can't come along and say that, oh, you know, our manuscripts are older. This reading of John of 1 John 5:7 didn't exist. So the Textus Receptus added it. Well, if you have a Latin Bible that's older, then the claim date on the B and Aleph and A, then it did exist. You understand?
Mm-hmm.
It did exist.
And where was it? Where was the original? Never mind.
What's the original you're talking about?
Well, when
in
up
Antioch.
There, up there.
In
up there in British and all those places where the old Latin.
Remember the trunk? The Mediterranean is like a tree trunk?
Yeah.
Okay, so it comes from Antioch. You have the gospel, you have the scripture being taken across the Mediterranean, and all of these different countries along the way. Finds its way up to Great Britain, France, in the Netherlands. Now, and then you have British missionaries that come to northern Italy and other places.
That's all
French.
We people have that. They're our ancestors.
Yes.
Us people, the mm-hmm. way we are.
But the point of the bringing up this Latin version is to demonstrate the fact that in the Vulgate, which they do with the Jerome's Vulgate, they wanted nothing to do with. They kept a hold of their old Latin. They didn't want the new Latin of Jerome, based on the wrong text, but they wanted to have their old Latin.
Okay.
And so if we look at page 141, he says, "It remains to us in the ancient Waldensian language, noble lesson, written about 1100 AD, which assigns the first opposition of the Waldensians to the Church of Rome to the days of Constantine the Great, when Sylvester was Pope. So we have this long period of persecution. But we see, still on page 141, it was the translation to the Latin which represents the received text. Its very name, Itala, is derived from the Italic district, the regions of Aldus, which is, again, where the Waldensians get their name. And so we have the purity of the Latin. It's pure. The old Latin liturgy, which was used in our services down through the centuries, contained the text of Scripture of the ancient version called the Italica. The Reformers held the Waldensian Church was formed about 120 A.D. from the Apostles. So here is 120, not 1100, but 120 A.D. from, not by Waldo, but from this group of people from Valdus, about 120. This is the date that it was formed. The Latin Bible in italic was translated from the Greek no later than 157. So that's early. That's real early. Tammy.
Isn't this area like northern Italy in the Alps? And so it was kind of isolated too?
It would be naturally isolated, yes. Yeah. You're right. It would be naturally isolated.
Italy?
In the Alps, northern Italy.
Waldus.
Geographically, it's hard to get to. So yeah, you have a double, it's doubly difficult.
What countries were hard to get to?
The land of the Waldensians.
The land of the Waldensians.
Okay, those that we're talking about.
Yes.
France, Spain.
No.
Northern Italy.
Northern Italy. That was the land of the Waldensians, Northern Italy?
Yes.
I hardly know what the Waldensians are now.
But here's Italy.
In the north of Italy, the Alps are there.
When you look at a map, you look for the blue. Okay, and that's,
I know what Italy looks like.
Okay. Now, north, yeah. Up in the northern part of Italy, you've been to Switzerland, haven't you, before?
Yes.
What's a famous mountain range that runs through Switzerland?
The Alps.
The Alps also run through northern Italy.
Oh, okay.
And so, consequently, if you're living in the Alps, living in the mountains, it's difficult to get to geographic, you know, it's not impossible, but it's a challenge to get to.
Right.
So they were insulated and isolated. As Tammy just said, that's a good way of looking at it, from the corruption.
That was sort of nice.
Yes.
That protected it all that.
Yes. Rome in the early days corrupted the manuscripts, where the Italic Church handed them down in their apostolic purity. So we have one group, the Roman Church, is busy corrupting them, but the Waldensian Church is handing it down in purity.
You know what it'd be like? Be like if we were here with the King James Bible and everybody else had different versions and everything. And years went by, and you know, somebody was here, Anna was still living here or something, and she had King James Bible. And somebody came in, they saw the King James Bible. They'd be so thrilled. They read about it in their classes. They'd never seen one. They read about it.
Okay.
Sort of like finding whatever that manuscript was. I forget what it is now. The Latin Bible and all that stuff. Did you learn these things in seminary?
Some of these things, not everything. Not much, but...
I don't remember learning this in Bible school. A lot of things, but...
I mean, there's those... I don't know. I can't say.
I can't remember what I learned.
In the silent watches of the night, along lonely paths of Asia Minor, where robbers and wild beasts lurked, might have been seen the noble missionaries carrying manuscripts and verifying documents from the churches in Judea to encourage their struggling brethren under the iron hand of the papacy.
Now, where is that?
It's on page 142.
In the middle of the page.
Very dramatic, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
I can't.
Continuing on page 142. If Rome in her own land was unable to beat down the testimony of the apostolic scriptures, how could she hope in the Greek-speaking world of the distant and hostile East to maintain the supremacy of her great Bible? And when, this is later on, a couple sentences down, and when the Greek East for 1,000 years was completely shut off from the Latin West, the noble Waldensians in northern Italy still possessed in Latin, the received text.
Isn't that beautiful?
It is. It is not true. It's not true, as the Roman Church claims, that she gave the Bible to the world. What she gave was an impure text, a text with thousands of verses so changed as to make way for unscriptural doctrines. The Waldensians were among the first of the people of Europe to obtain a translation of the Holy Scriptures. Hundreds of years before the Reformation, they possessed the Bible in manuscript in their native tongue, had the truth unadulterated, and this rendered them the special objects of hatred and persecution. Here for 1,000 years, witness for the truth, maintained the ancient faith in a most wonderful manner. It, the word of truth, was preserved uncorrupted through the ages of darkness. The struggle against the Bible adopted by Constantine was won. But another warfare, another plane of deluge, the Latin West, was a corrupt Latin Bible was preparing. We hasten to see how the world was saved from Jerome and his Origenisms. Because the Waldensians, they held on to the true Latin Bible, the old Latin Bible.
It's very dramatic.
Wasn't the Gallic Church that used the, that were the Albigensians?
Yes, the Albigensians.
Mm-hmm. Were the Gallic Church.
Yes.
In southern France, which is like just over the Alps from,
right.
from mm-hmm. Italy.
Right, they would be. They would be close, I mean, in the close, you know, close proximity, relatively speaking.
But it would be very
far. Difficult. It'd be
far because there's the all mountains in between.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
What is the bottom of that map? What is that?
Oh, here's Spain.
Okay. So that's on
that's
the left.
Spain.
That's good to see that. That's where the Bible was in the Latin?
No, Italy. Northern Italy.
That's Italy there.
Yeah. Then they got France, you know, here and so forth.
Huh.
France is up here. But still, maybe it's southern, more southern France or whatever.
Switzerland is
there between them.
That's why most of those countries there, Christianity is dead, because
mm-hmm.
they were infected by Rome.
Yes, that's right.
For so long mm-hmm. that they were under the oppression of the Roman Church.
Right.
Now people today, they don't want anything to do with it because of that.
They don't. Thoughts, comments, or questions about this section? Bill, we'll start with you.
No, nothing. That's pretty clear.
Very, very interesting historical section mm-hmm. today.
Yes, very moving.
A whole lot of Latin. Your thoughts or observations there, Mom?
It's very, very moving and very exciting. And it helps explain. And then, like you said, missionaries came with their books. I don't know what they were. I don't know if they were scrolls or what. They weren't scrolls, I don't think. They brought the Bible or whatever. I don't remember what.
Manuscripts. Mm-hmm.
And they plowed along with these Bibles, these awkward things. The scriptures in their own language or some other language. I don't know what language.
Tammy, some thoughts you might have.
I think it's interesting that, you know, even all the way to England, we had the Textus Receptus, and
mm-hmm.
they held to it against, you know, Rome, the Roman, and the Romans and the Saxons, they were kind of working together, and that was interesting. I was reading that. So I did have a question about something he said at the beginning, where. Just your interpretation. On page 135 at the beginning, it says, "In approaching this and other versions, we begin on the premise that God was actively superintending the translation of His word into other languages."
Yeah, superintending. I would use the word superintending.
Okay.
I was not comfortable with the word superintending.
Do you think that would be a reference to an inspired position?
Not necessarily, but it could. I can see why someone would.
It could lead to
could think
conclusion.
That. You have to use that terminology. Yes.
So how would you explain it, or would you just omit the whole thought?
You, I mean, you superintending, I mean.
Heading up?
You guided or gave wisdom?
Providentially leading, I mean, it's maybe semantical a little bit, the wording you would use, but see, the superintending, so often you hear the term superintending, you know, applied to the originals. And so, leading and guiding, perhaps. Yeah. I mean, it's probably a synonym. Probably means the same thing, but superintending just seems too strong. Too strong of a word, but.
Okay, I was just wondering about that, because I know there's a lot of confusion.
I mean, the guide certainly can give the translators wisdom and direction. And guidance. And he does.
Because it wasn't inspired.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Version. That's correct. I mean, the versions aren't inspired.
No, they're not. Any additional thoughts? Any additional thoughts, Tammy? You have about this today's?
Those are mostly it. I had to read it real rapidly, so I have to go back.
You probably became more than I did.
No, I don't think so.
Okay. How about you, Anna? Thoughts you have?
I didn't read it at all, but it sounded very interesting.
Good.
You'll have to read it.
Yeah, that's good. This page is just 10 pages, or whatever, it's 11 pages, 143 to 134 to 143. So, it's about 10 pages.
Uh-oh.
Any additional thoughts anyone has? Phil, go ahead and close this in prayer, please.
Father in heaven, we thank you for this lesson. We thank you for the class. We thank you for this church who's providing these classes to us. And we thank you for all of the knowledge that you have kept intact for us to study from and learn. And we come to this because we seek the truth. We don't just accept the words of tradition and of minds that are corrupted for lack of knowledge. Father, we thank you for everything that you provide for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.